I needed more storage, and these big 28 terabyte external hard drives seems like a decent value pick to get a lot of storage on dense platters at a relatively low price. And in this video, I'm gonna take these drives, run them through a variety of tests, shuck them and find out what's inside, and just go through a variety of tests to see if these drives are actually a decent value pick for something like home servers, where trying to get the best value out of drives makes sense. Or if maybe you should just look at the actual NAS rated drives and not try to save a buck. So let's talk a little bit about the situation that's gotten me to the point of buying these drives in the first place. My main home server has 6 8-terabyte drives in essentially a RAID 5 or RAID Z1 configuration. I have effectively filled that array. I'm at about 1 to 2 terabytes free, so I am well past the point of I should probably buy more drives by now. And the other thing is, I have another server with roughly 30 terabytes of media that I want to have online that I have kept off in order to save power. So I want to get all of that data onto a single server and do it while pulling less power. I also have a new 4-bay server, which I'll likely talk about in later videos. So I got a total of 4 of these drives to take a look at. And my thought was, I want to get as dense of platters as possible so I have upgrade space, can store my other media, and can use relatively little power, and I want to do it as cheaply as possible. And these drives seem to check some of those boxes for me. They seem to have reasonably high quality drives, and while not as good as a truly NAS rated drive, they come at a pretty good value, so looking at it, I could either buy 4 NAS rated drives of about the same capacity, or I could buy these 4 externals and essentially just buy a replacement if I need to, and still be at about the same point monetarily. The problem with all of this speculation when it comes to how long the drives will last and everything is, it's all probability and statistics, and I don't have great data. So I'm gonna try to answer the questions the best I can with the drive I have when it comes to performance, make a few speculations, and let me know in the comments below if you've used these drives and what your thoughts on these are, and if they make sense. Let's actually just first take a look at the physical drives I get. These are external hard drives, which they seem to be using as a way of selling cheaper, lower grade drives, or perhaps just relabeled drives, at a lower price point than like the NAS or enterprise rated drives of the same capacity. And it's hard to get exact details because with these external hard drives, they seem to be kind of a, you get what you get a lot of the times, as they don't list a lot of specifics like RPM and the exact model of drive that's included in here. Oh, here's the actual external hard drive itself. They've kept this packaging forever. And then the little container with the power brick and the USB 3.0 micro B connector, which unfortunately they've still used even on what appears to be essentially a new model drive. I first want to start off by just trying it as an external hard drive. So I plugged it into my little stream PC right here, and I have Crystal Disk Mark set up on this hard drive right here, as well as Crystal Disk Info, just to see what the hard drive says. One interesting thing to note is while Crystal Disk Info works without a problem in Windows to see smart data, in my Linux system, smart control needs an extra parameter added to it. Here's the command I found worked, or if I didn't find one, I won't put it there. But it won't just work like plug and play, like Crystal Disk Info. The other thing I want to note is this hard drive is relatively loud, I would say. When it's idle like it is right now, it's pretty quiet and fits into the background. But when it starts doing seek sounds, it gets quite noticeably loud when you're doing random I.O. And I would say in the category of, I don't want it on my desk if I am in a quiet workspace and don't want to hear the drive. Otherwise, looking at smart data, this looks like any other drive to me. It's SATA drive with a UASP adapter. These are essentially brand new drives, all reporting 0 hours when I've used them with just a couple on off out. And all the smart data, I will note this is all hex and hasn't been converted, looks perfectly fine for a new drive. I do want to also note that I have been running extended tests on these drives, and you get a bit over 270 megabytes per second in outside or the fastest speed. I think about 130 on the inside, an average speed of just a hair under 200 megabytes per second, which means on these 28 terabyte drives, it takes over 30 hours to do a full read or write of all of the data on it, which is quite poor in my opinion, and means that RAID rebuilds will take a while. Because hard drives, while they're getting a little bit faster as capacity goes up and density of the drives, they have mostly grown in capacity significantly faster than speed. So while this is faster than something like a 14 terabyte hard drive, it's a handful of percent faster, and meaning it would take significantly longer to do RAID rebuilds, for example. Overall performance of this drive, I would say, is on par with any other high-performance 7200 RPM drive I've seen on the market. Crystal Disk Info seems to be acting a bit odd. I don't know if it's USB on the system. But on my actual performance testing, it looks just fine. Another thing that I've seen rumored online with these hard drives is that they're actually dual actuator drives and just completely unbranded and just put in a normal enclosure, not treated as such. The way that it seems to be able to tell if it's a dual actuator drive is taking a look at the performance of this drive over time. A traditional hard drive will just start at its highest speed on the outside of the disk and slow down. A dual actuator drive, in the way that these have been implemented, which is essentially they have the first actuator and set of LBAs, and then in the second set will essentially have a sawtooth-like wave. So the speed speeds up, drops down, and then switches to the second actuator and does it. This is not optimal for performance, and people have made scripts to partition for it. So let's see if my drives act this way. So what I've done to test if it's a dual actuator drive and how I believe they're typically implemented in these externals is just log the performance over time, throw it in a little spreadsheet graphing program here, in this case LibreOffice Calc, and taking a look, I see the fully expected performance graph where the performance just slowly drops as I use more and more space into the hard drive. So I right now do not see anything to indicate that this is a dual actuator drive. Although, like I said earlier, it's kind of the luck of the draw of these external drives, so some of these might be dual actuator drives for all I know, but I don't see a reason to believe that right now. And everything on this external drive looks fine to me, so I think it's time to start ripping this drive open and seeing what's inside. Now, some people have a technique where they can open these drives up and essentially not make it look like they pried it open. I do not have that technique, and I believe in the US, I still should legally have a full warranty if I take the drive apart, because taking the drive apart should not damage the actual hard drive itself. So, let's get cracking this drive open. My other mindset is I generally like to just plug these drives into a system, make sure they appear and copy a couple of files. My mindset is if they can do that, their chance of early failure is pretty low, so I don't find the need to do an extended test when in the enclosures to lower the chance of me having to deal with returns. So in this case, I'm gonna just take a little metal flathead screwdriver and go around this side, and just pry up until I get those clips to give. And here it is inside. It's a 28 terabyte Barracuda drive. Just for fun, I'm gonna take this number, which is an ST28000DM000 drive, and throw it on Google and just see, is this a hard drive I can buy in the retail market? From a quick Google, it looks like even though this drive is branded as a Barracuda hard drive, there does not seem to be any consumer product, and all of the results from looking at this model number is the external drive. So it's interesting, he branded it as Barracuda, I guess that's what would make sense. But there it is. The other thing that I immediately noticed on here is the date of manufacture is 29th of January 2025. It is currently September 18th, so this drive is almost 8 months old, I believe. So it's definitely been sitting around for a bit, and they've been making these drives for a little bit. Turning it around, I can just pop it out pretty easily. Now, the other thing is they've changed how the actual drive is stored in here. On previous of these external drives I've taken apart, this little USB board has the actual SATA connector on it. And then on this one, it has a little board right here that has a cable. It's interesting they chose to change that. I'm curious why. At first glance, I feel like a cable would be a more expensive solution. Also, quick complaint, the warranty void. Please don't do this. It's not legal in the US, so it's not enforceable. Why do they do this? So, with a quick slice of that warranty void sticker, I should be able to pop this off, peel off the tape, and get my internal hard drive to use inside a server. And then looking at the rest of it here, I have the basic circuit board with the cable here, and I'll pop this out and just take a look at the chips they've been using. To my knowledge, these chips have been about the same for a decade now, as USB to SATA connectors have just not really changed at all. Once I take off all the screws, the plastic, metallic tape, and more, it's a normal 28 terabyte drive. Standard retail appearing marketing on the front, a standard circuit board and motor connection on the back. It's a helium-filled drive with a lot of platters, so I only have two screw holes on the bottom, but I have three on the sides. So, yeah. Let's try it in another system. Actually, before I do try it in another system, Out of pure curiosity, I'm going to pop off the circuit board to see if anything looks strange underneath in there. But I'm guessing I'm just going to see a standard mechanical hard drive controller board in here. Pretty standard looking circuit board with what appears to be a main controller chip here, interface to the heads and other stuff in the drive right here, and then a motor controller here by Smooth Motor. And then hiding under this little fabric here is a small, what looks like probably DRAM chip for a little bit of caching. This is all standard mechanical hard drive, but compared to like older gen drives I have here, it is shrunk quite a bit smaller, likely because all of those platters require more space in here. Now, one other thing I'm curious about is now I have this hard drive enclosure here with a little bit of a USB to SATA adapter. Can I take a random old hard drive I have laying around, put it in this enclosure, and just use it for insert random old hard drive here? As sometimes I find it really nice to be able to reuse these enclosures with random old drives to either use as external backup drives or give them to friends or anyone else so they can have extra storage drives with my old, what I consider to be small capacity drives. So let's see if this drive works and shows up in Windows. So I tried a random 250 gigabyte Seagate drive from over a decade ago now. Shows up on the system, shows all the smart data correctly, shows up in Windows. Everything works great, so that means I'm now going to have four more external hard drive disk controllers laying around. So, awesome to see. Just out of curiosity's sake, I took out the circuit board inside one of these enclosures. The date seems to be from 2021, which is pretty old, might even explain why it's using micro USB-B on here instead of a newer connector, but extremely simple circuitry. To my knowledge, USB to SATA adapters have just not changed for a decade. They've been able to reach SATA speeds, and it's been fine. These enclosures are great to see that they're reusable and otherwise work just fine. One interesting thing I noticed when I was using my external hard drive doing my sustained write test, in case I used the FIO command to write over the whole drive to see its performance and logged it, is that the performance seems to start from its like peak of about 260, 270 megabytes per second and then drop to the hundreds and then go back up. Potentially this could be a dual actuator drive, but it, as I showed earlier, did not act that way with reads. The other thing that it could possibly be doing is thermal throttling. In these included cases, these drives get into the 50 some degrees Celsius. And in my personal opinion, 50 degrees is about the limit for how hot I ever want hard drives to get. So they're a bit above it. Now, I have used these sorts of drives in external enclosures for things like backups of systems that did run at sustained periods at those almost 60 degree temperatures without issue. So they can do it. But it's likely not good, and it is possible they're slowing down. I did shuck one of these drives after it's been running for quite a while, and the drive was quite hot. I could not hold it comfortably for any sustained period of time because of how hot it gets. I think these cases are just barely enough cooling for the amount of heat these drives make. One other thing I wanted to try with these drives is using the hdparm-y command to spin them down immediately. This would test if spin down works to save power on these drives if you're using them in idle. So I got my hand on the drive, I'm gonna issue the command, and I feel it, and it seems to be spinning down correctly, and the drive is fully spun down right now. I don't feel it vibrating at all. And then if I do a DD command, which should read some data from that drive, it immediately spins back up, showing that the standby command, if used correctly, will tell the drive to spin down and start back up. So if you wanna use that function on something like Unraid or even TrueNAS or Proxmox when set up that way, it should just work. So, from everything I can see, while these drives are sold as external drives with possibly other caveats, they work fine in systems with 3.3 volt power, they are plug and play in a couple of systems behind me I've tested them on, and they don't have any real issues. So, for all extents and purposes, these are normal desktop drives. What's the power consumption on these drives? It looks like when they're spinning and idle in their external enclosure, it's about 8.5 watts. And if I go throw a random IO workload on the drive via Crystal Disk Mark, it pops up to about 11 watts. So these are 7200 RPM drives, and these drives fall in line with kind of my rough number of a single 3.5 inch hard drive adds roughly 10 watts to the wall to your system by average. So after running these tests and shucking these drives, from what I can see, they seem to be pretty close to about the same when it comes to features as a NAS rated drive, and checks all the boxes I have for wanting to work in a NAS. Reasonable power consumption, noise isn't personally an issue for me, performance is pretty good, 7200 RPM, and nothing odd that I can see in my initial testing. So now comes the big question of, at least for me, does it make sense to get these cheaper drives, or does it make sense to get a NAS rated drive? The way I see it is I am a lot more cost conscious than many other people might be, and I'd like to try to save that money if I can. As a quick size comparison, I could get these 28 terabyte external drives for the mid 300s, depending on sales and everything else. And a NAS rated drive of about the same capacity would be roughly $500 plus minus a bit. So for the cost of four NAS rated large hard drives, I could get five of these. So my thought is buy four now, I can run off and get a fifth one if I have a failure. And most of the time, I probably won't have a failure in the super near term and be winning price wise. And even if I do have a failure, I'm not going to be that far behind. Now, the problem is that's running on the idea that the failure rate isn't going to be much worse, so assuming only one drive would fail. And in my experience of hard drives, that's probably going to be the case, but unfortunately, there's no good public data to build that off of. Places like Backblaze, which is really awesome for posting all the public data they have, don't test every drive model. And you actually have to have quite a few hard drives to get a, I'd say, fairly small margin of error to actually compare drives and say that this drive model is statistically significantly less likely to fail than another drive model. The other issue is you have to test drives for an extended period of time if you want to do actual real-world testing. Otherwise, you have to find out some way to do an accelerated failure testing because drives can take many years or decades to get a good failure data on them. So maybe I'll be proven wrong, but kind of based off my gut and data I've seen, I'm guessing the idea of buying these drives now will win. Now, one of the other things I do get buying higher end drives is a better warranty. They typically give you a 3 or 5 year warranty compared to the 2 year warranty on these drives, which are also relatively limited in their workload ratings, which I think basically just means if they see you've used the drive too much when it comes to hours or data copied, they'll just not do your warranty to keep you from using it in NAS use. My personal opinion is that for my use cases of drives, I typically have the ability to buy the drive whenever I want. Warranties are kind of a pain because I have to ship them a drive and wait for it to arrive back. So that could easily be 2 weeks or more waiting for another hard drive versus going out to the store and buying another drive the same day. So I don't see a much longer warranty as a big value add for me personally. It's kind of a pain in my opinion to work with. It's easy to forget about. And I would rather save the money typically than get the warranty on something like a hard drive. So I think for my use case where it's not mission critical data, it's in a RAID array, and everything critical is being backed up, I see that saving money is likely going to result in a cheaper drive for me without too much extra hassle or risk. Now, does this make sense to you? Let me know in the comments below. I'm curious what your thoughts on these drives are, but especially if you get these on a good sale, I think they can certainly make sense for a home server use case where getting relatively cheap dense drives makes sense. Does my reasoning for trying to get these cheaper drives instead of buying full-blown NAS drives make sense to you? What drives would have you gotten? Let me know in the comments below. And also, if you have any other tests you want me to run on these drives, let me know. Most likely, if I have a major issue or anything weird going on these drives, I'll make a post or a comment and I'll let everyone know what's going on with these. But I think for now, I don't have any reasons to immediately regret my decision. And I'm looking forward to see how these drives age and act potentially 5 years from now, and hopefully they're still spinning well-working drives. Thanks for watching this little video on these external hard drives, and I hope you found this data useful or perhaps entertaining.